Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for spending your Saturday for this session. It is my first session to such an audience, so please do pardon if I do some silly mistakes or common unknown mistakes. But I'll be happy to hear your feedback, happy to improve, and hopefully happy to present again. So a bit introduction about myself. So I'm Vaibhav Khandelwal. I'm co-founder and CTO at Shadowfax. Shadowfax is India's leading last mile or express logistics network. We are present in 200 cities now. We do around 1,50,000 orders, 1.5 lakh orders on a daily basis. We have a fleet of 10,000 plus delivery partners, which are on a crowdsource model working with us. And it has been a good journey for us for the past 3.5 years. In terms of the clientele, we work with almost all the bigger enterprises that you guys have seen from a consumer standpoint. We are not a consumer-facing company. We are an entirely B2B organization. So we work with McDonald's, we work with Domino's, we work with Swiggy, Big Basket, Paytm, Snapdeal, Myntra. We work with all these clients and we do fulfillment of the last mile orders for them. And the team is headquartered in Bangalore. We do have offices across the country as well. So now moving on to the presentation, what I want to talk about here. So as the title says, the product development for fleet management. So my agenda or my brief outline of this conversation or this talk would be on the lines that I would first want to highlight a bit about the persona of these delivery boys, that what kind of people are they, what are their likes, what are their dislikes. And it will be more, then we'll focus on the two parts of it. One is the engineering challenges and our learnings from that. And second are the product level challenges that we have faced, that we have learned things from them. The overall objective of this talk is not to say that this method works good or this method works bad, but primarily to share our learnings, to share our experiments, what we did in when we observed those problems and how we tried to figure out a solution to them. So that will be the overall outline of my talk here. I'll be happy to take questions after the presentation, online as well as offline as well. So yeah. Moving on to the first section, the rider persona or the delivery boy persona. So what kind of these, how do we describe these delivery partners? So basis our interviews, basis our conversations, these are the guys who are the ones which are fulfilling the consumer apps or the consumption powers of the 50 million Indians. These are the second part of India, or a couple of us also refer as Bharat versus India debate of sorts. Now, these are the guys who have good aspirations. They want to do big in life, but because of limitations in education, because of limitation in opportunities, they are not able to do that. What do they, you talk to almost all of them and everyone would want to earn and make more and more money. There is no saturation. I mean, they would not come and tell you that we would not want to maximize our earnings. They'll try to figure out their ways. Then what are the difficulties that they observe? So finding the exact location, having erratic customer experiences as well. So to be honest, we have heard case studies where, so we do reverse logistics as well. So we have heard case studies where the customer has held the delivery boy as hostage and said that I won't release this guy unless Paytm refunds back my money. So these have been the scenarios and this is what these guys take care of. You see any good delivery experience or image or a video, what you will see is a happy customer. What you will never see is that delivery boy who is just a plain simple guy fulfilling all these tasks for you. And that is where these guys are. They are in the shadows. They will be penalized if they do wrong. And they won't be appreciated much if they do good. So that is the kind of persona here. In terms of motivation, again, money is the major motivation. recognition, as we'll talk about more as well, the social recognition is also an important part here. What are the apps that these guys use? So ShareChat, TikTok. So with the advent of Jio, actually the video consumption has actually taken off. And to an interesting part, what we observed was that just after Jio, almost a large number of the phone numbers were starting with the number 6, which was technically Jio. So almost everyone flocked that into going into Jio. And these are the guys who want to maximize their savings and earnings. Another persona, so this guy is married. Education is 10th pass. Again, not many opportunities available in life to do to earn big or become big. Then another goal, and that comes with age, is to have a stable and secure job. So very few people of us, or very few, I mean, if you consider this outsourced, crowdsourced economy, the gig economy, so people feel that paying on a per transaction basis is absolutely fine because you are able to minimize your risk. You do not have to associate for a fixed contract with anybody. Whereas these delivery boys, when they get into a family, they would want a stable fixed job. So just to explain it in some numbers, it is more like a delivery boy is fine if you give him a payout somewhere between 12,000 to 15,000 versus giving that guy a payout somewhere between 8,000 to 20,000. So these guys, they would prefer lesser of variance and more of stability. Now, different personas have different identities, different companies have different preferences about it. But just wanted to highlight some commonalities and differences in the thought processes among all these guys. So this will, the reason why I'm highlighting this, or the reason why I'm discussing is just to set up the context on what sort of people are we talking about? What actually is fleet management? How different are they? How similar are they from us? So now I'll move on to, just this context is set up, I'll now move on to engineering challenges and the learnings. So as I told, the conversation would be split into two parts. One is what engineering challenges you foresee, what are the engineering challenges one get to know, and how can, some ways in which we have learned how to overcome that, and then later on the product part of it. So the first thing here is the locations. As simple as that, with the advent of Uber and similar related startups, people realize that just by tracking locations, you can actually make a lot of decision making in the process. But tracking location in itself is a very complex problem to solve. So what are the challenges? I'll just try to focus here. So one is patchy network. So even with all that 4G coming in, still there is inconsistencies in the network that are there. Now you would ask that Ola and Uber work perfectly fine here. What are the challenges that these fleet have in addition to that? So just consider where these guys have to travel to. So the majority of the transactions of a delivery boy, they happen at the customer doorstep. The majority of the time that the partner is waiting is near the restaurant. The hubs are generally outside the city with having lesser population and coverage. In these areas, you would have also observed that in the doorstep point, in the indoors, in the basements, your internet connectivity is not that great. And for this delivery boy, marking delivered or getting the online payment, every transaction depends on these major hotspots only. So not a major problem, but yes, once you start seeing it at scale, you would figure it out that this is a major problem. Second is on the battery drain. So again, you would see in Ola and Uber, they have a USB plugged in into it. Similar adjustments, yes, do exist in bikes, but they are not that successful and scalable. And since locations are privy to the customer experience, locations are privy to the earnings that a partner can make. Therefore, ensuring that the partner is alive for the maximum duration on your platform is of utmost importance. You cannot just keep polling the location and allow the battery to drain out in 4 to 5 hours. You need to optimize that thing because that partner, the delivery boy, is actually on the move, and the entire experience, the entire earnings of that partner depends on that. So I'll focus on a couple of learnings that we have taken in this process. One is on the MQTT protocol. Just a quick check on how many have heard about this protocol earlier or maybe use it. Sounds fair. So I think there is a good audience that knows about it. So primarily, so earlier what we were doing it over an HTTP protocol, and we were transmitting location data using a socket that was created, and that used to drain the battery at a good amount of, in a very small limited amount of time. Then we thought that we would keep polling the location and we will open the socket and send across the location only at a particular point of time, thereby reducing the battery drainage that is there in the socket opening and closing. Then we stumbled upon this protocol that is MQTT protocol. So those working in the IoT sector, this is actually the machine-to-machine language protocol. Earlier was used for satellite communication as well. So it sends data as bytes, and it does not have all that. What I would say, the confirmation of the proof of delivery, like as of HTTPA, but it allows you to transmit data at even in patchy networks, that includes 2G networks as well. The battery drainage in keeping an MQTT socket open is lesser than the battery usage if you intermittently open and close the HTTP socket. And this is not in single digits, it is a multiplier effect. So I'll be happy to share some links as I move along where people have done the benchmarking on the battery drain part, on keeping an MQTT socket open and changing in the HTTP socket duration. So this was one of the major thing that helped us, and what we created was a backup mechanism wherein the location would be first sent across the MQTT PubSub network, and then would, if failovers are there on a repeated basis, then it would be taken on an HTTP protocol. This significantly helped us in getting locations even in the patchy networks. This significantly helped us in reducing the battery drain. Some numbers I have highlighted here. I am not sure how clear will they be to the audience, but yeah. We have seen that we are now able to have, even using our application, even if you use it for the entire day, the battery drain is 7% an hour. What that results in is 14 hours, roughly of 14 hours of continuous app usage with continuous location data at the right frequencies that you need it for the right customer experience. Moving on, next is on the location strategies. So again, the important thing here is that it is not, you should not keep polling location at a particular frequency. You can look to optimize your strategy as to when you want to poll the location and when you do not want to poll it. Some trigger points may be, so once the rider is delivering an order, you definitely want your customer to have a real-time tracking experience. At that point of time, you can actually increase the frequency of getting locations from the partner. When the partner is idle, you do not need it at that high frequency. You just need it for the decision-making that the partner is in that vicinity or not. Second is when you do get signals from the battery, on the battery low percentage that is available, you can consume that. You can have these strategies created basis the area in which the partner is working and the criticality of the task that you would want to track. So some and other configurations, majorly the changes were done. Once you are able to do this decision making on the server, you can just configure it pretty quick. Another important thing that I would want to discuss here is that the hardware configurations. So of you who have worked on Android and have tried to capture locations, you would say that it's very easy to write a code for capturing location. It is just a single line of code where you say that I would want the location frequency at 30 seconds, for example, and Android will handle everything for you. But once you start going into depth of things, you realize that hardware does not behave in that way. So for example, if you set the same code in Oppo devices, you would realize that your location is, let's say you have set the frequency as 30 seconds, you would realize that you are receiving your locations maybe after a minute. Once you set it in Samsung, you see you might get your locations even in 25 seconds as well. Now this was surprising to us as well. We were initially debugging our own code. We were initially trying to reach out to the Google fellows that what wrong are we writing in here. But then as more and more when we read about it, we figured that this is how these different sensors behave. The Chinese OEMs, they focus more on your selfie camera than on your GPS sensor. And if you see the distribution of what these guys have, you would figure that 34% is Vivo. So that is where the entire gamut is. So what we did was an interesting bit here. So we had the past data on all the devices of different brands. We created a model on top of it. And what we created was, we created two different frequencies. So one is the business frequency and the other is the device frequency. So the business frequency, let's say, is the business says that I need to get a location in every minute, in every 1 minute. Basis the model, basis the past location data received for these different mobile phones, you then forecast, you then predict what is the frequency that I need to tell to this device. And that configuration is done basis the server. So technically I can, sitting here, modify at what frequency should I order this device to send locations onto. And that forecast actually allowed us to save in more battery, because some devices, some hardwares are really good. Whatever you tell them, they'll figure it out according to them. So for example, in Samsung, I could just say that share location in 1 minute and it will give me in 1 minute. But for Oppo, I would have to say that share location in 30 seconds so that even if it misses one beat, I'm able to get it in a minute as well. So that has helped us using our past data for different OEMs. And that is one of the other things that has helped us to save battery at the same. Moving on to the next thing, on the routing engines and ETA prediction. So another crucial thing. So, I mean, whatever, I think, there have been talks by Divya on the run sheet automation. There have been talks from the Swiggy folks on the batching, maximizing the batching. Almost every logistics problem or every last mile problem will involve routing. You need to do these optimization calculations at which is the perfect route for you to figure it out. Now, there are multiple ways of doing it. I mean, I'm not going into how do you create the best routes. I'm going into the basic need the basic prerequisite for creating a route. You would need the ETA between two nodes for you to be able to make a decision. So let's say I have 10 orders. I would want that for all combinations, I should know what is the time that it will take from this node to this node. Only then I'll be able to create some sort of a logic for the routing engine. Now, capturing this ETA can be done in multiple ways. The simple method would be taking the Heaviside distance between the two coordinates and taking a fixed velocity, dividing it, and you get an ETA. Or by ETA, what I mean is the time that it will take from point A to point B, the amount of time that it will take to reach there. Now, why this method fails? Because this is the airline distance. This does not take into account the road distance or the one-way part. The positives of this is that it is super quick. You can get results pretty quick. The second method is use the Google Distance Matrix API. Google has an API wherein you can supply in your input nodes and get the out and the destination nodes, and it will give you an output in a distance matrix. Now, what I am going to say is that this is not the preferred method if you are working at scale. As simple as that, your response times for a Google Matrix API would be in the orders of 100 to 150 ms. Now, when you are creating a run sheet, for example, of 30 orders, you would want 30 C2 combinations to be evaluated as distance. And maybe when you are doing order batching in the case of Swiggy or in the real-time orders, you would want this computation to be done even in a more real-time fashion. So if you just keep on adding it, it will limit on the number or on the complexity of the algorithm that you can run. Second is that it is really expensive. Once you are using it as an asset tracking tool, once you are using it on a work basis, it is really expensive. Yes, it can definitely fulfill your costs that you are paying for it. But yes, it is decently expensive at in the tunes of like $3,000 on a monthly basis. This is the kind of calculations that we were expecting to do. So what we again stumbled on, again thing, and again I would want to ask, how many of you have heard about or used OSRM? Great. So OSRM, again, it's open source routing machine. So this is basically what this engine is. This is technically a C++ library, uses A star algorithm to optimize the route. What it will do is, given any graph, it will find you the shortest distance between from going from point A to point B. And it will give you in a response times of 5 to 10 ms. Now, what we do is that you feed in the OpenStreetMaps data onto this OSRM. That creates, that gives in the graph data for one way, that this is a one way, this is a road, this is how these different nodes are connected. And then you run OSRM on it and you would get the road distance from going from point A to point B in a response time of 5 to 10 milliseconds. And this, you can host it on your own servers. And with the volume that I am referring here, we are working at a T2 medium level, and it costs you roughly 1% of what the Google APIs would cost you. And not much of a maintenance hassle as well. And this is something which Uber also uses it. What negative exists here? The negative is that definitely does not have the traffic data that Google has. How can you overcome this con here? So OSRM allows you to give weightage to each of the edges. You can upload weights to each of the edges, and accordingly, it will optimize and figure out the best path for you. And what people, I mean, this is my discussion with data scientists at Uber and a couple of other folks that I know there. What we have figured out is that even Uber is also using their cab data to feed it into OSRM to actually create a replica of what Google Maps is. That is an entirely 100% in-house solution, very high, very less latencies, and really helps. The third thing that I'll focus here is the location familiarity. Now, this is something that we realized after talking to delivery partners. Now, so these delivery, I mean, you could create a routing engine that is the most optimal, that will give you the best results. But there will be difficulty in adopting it on ground. Why? Because delivery boys, they are familiar with a particular area and they would want to work in a particular area. They would want to get orders, their last orders, near to the area where they live. And that is something which is a known conversation that happens in an offline manner. So if you see, if you go to any of the e-commerce hub, you'll find that these are the pin codes reserved for this delivery boy. And this is some sort of an understanding that has built up. How do you take it out into your system? And that is what we have done. We have tried to incorporate the location familiarity into the routes that we create. We ensure that these, I mean, you basis the past history of the location data of these partners, you can figure out where is this partner most likely to know that place and reach that place, and then take it up and then create the route so that these are referred to that guy. So these are on the routing engines and the ETA, again, broadly learnings, what we have figured out that this can work, this will not work. And now I'll move on to the product development learnings that we have had. So first thing is on the gamification. So again, The thing will stem from the fact that let's understand what is the life of a delivery boy. Now, there is a repetitive task on a daily basis. He has to come in the morning, go to the outlet, take up orders, deliver it to the customer. It's on and on, again and again. There is no brain involved. There is no new thing, new surprises. There is nothing in that zone. Then there is no promotion or there is no career growth, if you see. I mean, even if a delivery boy has worked for you for 2 years, he's expected to do the same work. There is no entitlement or a senior delivery boy or something of that sort. And then there is erratic consumer behavior as well. I mean, they have to bear the wraths and the negativities that some consumers do have. And so, and see, in India, in general, we want the balance of both. We want low cost and we want the best service. And if we are paying money, then we would want the best service, even if that money is 10 rupees. So that is the kind of consumer behavior that these guys are expected to, and that is some sort of a life of a delivery boy. So consider yourself being in those shoes and you would figure that it is a very boring life. It's a very monotonous, dull life. There is no motivation left. How do you create that motivation? That is the challenge. That is the problem statement that we have tried to handle. So I'll talk about the two different methodologies. One is the social recognition part. The other is the carrot and stick model. So the carrot and stick model is that you incentivize on good performance, you you find these partners on the bad performance or missing the SLA or doing the wrong part of it. While this works, this definitely works because the most impactful thing for partners is the money. So if you're starting to find them, they will definitely start to improve or maybe bypass the system. They are also known good for that. So, but then again, that is absolute. That will have impact on your attrition levels. There are lots of psychological things that this might not be the best way forward for these guys. Then the other part is the social recognition. Stems from the fact that these partners, they stay in a community. So you see the Swiggy guys, they'll stay together. You see Zomato, they'll stay together. Now, what matters more to these guys is that, yes, they are made to feel proud in front of their colleagues. And that is something that you can create a virtual currency on. That is something that you can actually take it up ahead and incentivize them. And that even works for us as well. I mean, I'm not sure why people put their personal photos on Facebook, but they do get that instant hit that, yes, people are recognizing that, yay, that this guy went to Paris. So, I mean, these are the kind of things that we have tried to figure it out. The screen on the right shows a sample screen on how the delivery boy would see. It's more like a magic score. Would not want to go more into the details because it's something related to, I mean, very core to Shadowfax and not many people would relate. But the overall thing is that it is more of a gamification. It is more of a way in which a metric in which you can recognize on a social level. So what we have done here is that we have created a leaderboard here. So a partner would be seeing his or her rank basis the vicinity, in the vicinity of 2 kilometers, how the other partners are behaving. Now it is more of a relative metric. What we have noticed is that there is a very high page visits of this page. And people generally tend to compete here. There are different kinds of groups that we have figured out that there are some people who would want to be the best among their group. And then there are some people who want their group should be better than the other group. So for example, the Kormangala Warriors would want to be better than the Indranagar Warriors. So these are the dynamics that you can tend to figure it out and can be used to motivate or incentivize these partners at different levels. What our learning says that yes, these delivery boys, they like such a concept and that adds some spice into their life there. Next, I will focus on the loyalty program. So again, the thing here is, in this market where heavily competitive, I mean, we have seen Foodpanda, Uber Eats, Swiggy, Zomato, increasingly giving a large number of payout on an ad hoc basis to these partners. trying to capture as much as possible the market share. Now, what you can do or what one can do to actually ensure that your partners are with you is to try to create a loyalty program. So one of the, I mean, outside this everything, I mean, one advice that one of my senior who worked at Pratham, he gave to us before starting this job. So he said that till date, these delivery boys are seen as blue collar people. They are seen, they are taken like laborers, and therefore they respond to you like laborers. If you can transform them into white collar people, if you can transform this delivery job as a white collar job, then these partners will start reflecting that ideology. If you start giving them transparency on the payout, if you start giving them joining bonus, I mean, whatever benefits that we get, application for leaves, paid leaves are there, there is a notice period associated. So all these things, if you can get, they will also respond in the same way. So I'll like to quickly move and present a quick video of the rewards program that we have created. So again, a virtual currency, I think self-explanatory, I would just leave it to the audience. I'm not sure why the audio is not working, but yeah. So yeah, the leaderboard part. So then moving quickly on the payouts part, I think almost everyone here realizes that the major part is if you want to build a brand, you would want to ensure trust. If you want to ensure trust, transparent and timely payouts is the key here. So again, some learnings from our show as much detail as possible to the partner so that the partner is able to clarify, verify and get proof that yes, this is a organization that I can trust. Have a support team for helping in the payout related queries, because that is the major thing that worries these partners. That is a major thing that will drive your retention levels. Then automate the calculation and execution process. Do not leave it for humans. Do not leave at the guidance of humans to calculate the payout, to update the payout, or even to release the payout. What we have done is that we have even integrated with the bank APIs, and the execution of the transfer of money to their bank account happens via that. That gives more visibility to the partner. What is the status of their payment? When will they get? How will they get? And what we have also observed is that once you have automated all these calculations, your issues also come to a lower point. So another point here that we were thinking, and so this is not something that we have worked on, but we have discussed it with or we have seen similar products in other geographies. So one of a similar player, what they do is that they give the option to withdraw at will. So a partner is shown the live balance, that this is the amount that he or she has earned at this point of time, and you can withdraw it if you want to withdraw it right now. So some innovations, some changes here, but do focus a lot on payout. If your payouts are transparent and are done on a timely manner, it will be much easier for you to manage your fleet. Again, then I'll focus on the in-app training methodologies. So training is must. Training is important to build your brand. Build your brand loyalty. These delivery boys, they like the fact that yes, the company with which they are working is present in 200 cities. So you would want this information to be communicated to these partners. It ensures good customer experience, allows you to give best practices. There are problems with the classroom training thing, where you cannot scale it properly. There is no track of how good the conversation is or how good the training is. And there is lack of personalization as well. What we have done is a small video here. This will, so what we understood was that videos consume better. So within the app itself, we have allowed these videos to be a part, and the delivery boy can, so we name it as Gurukul. The delivery boy can go there, do the chapters, and earn a surprise money. So that was something related to what we learned from Google Pay, which actually worked good. And then vernacular content is really, really important. For these delivery boys, if you throw, I mean, they can understand your keywords of the apps, but if you give them very decent content, it'll be difficult for them to understand, and they'll generally skip that content. So yeah, a quick look on the, I think I'll, in the interest of time, I'll move ahead. Then fraud detection, I guess that's the last slide for me. So build that pretty early. So a lot of people will feel ki, this is not where I would get my revenue. This is not where I'll optimize my cost right away. But when you're working at scale, it is important for you to have a module in place which takes care of the frauds. What these frauds do, A, obviously the economical impact, but the other important impact is that it creates the bad practices among other genuine partners who feel that those who are making fraud, they are able to get away pretty early, pretty easily. So do not have a, I mean, have a zero tolerance policy here. I mean, define bad apples, define your values that, hey guys, this is not acceptable at any given point of time. And so another important thing is, so we are a big proponent of Aadhaar KYC. I mean, if this platform is of any help, we would definitely would want to sign up a petition that please enable Aadhaar KYC for players, private players like us. This was a really, really good way for us to verify our partners, to verify the genuineness of the partners. Very quick and reliable process to take it up ahead. But the reality is it's still not available for us. So we have tried to do a couple of things so as to be really sure on the documents, on the items that we have. So we do the image processing on the PAN card, because PAN card is an important document that needs to be taken. We have integration with the PAN APIs. Then background verification again is important. It will generally help you when and ever. So it's more like an insurance. If things go wrong, this would be something that will be of help to you. Then bank account verification, again, an important thing. I'll move on to the location intelligence part. Would focus a couple of things on this. How many of you have used Kepler? Pretty less. Interesting. So I'll bring a new thing to the audience. So please visit Kepler.gl, a wonderful, wonderful visualization tool. Again, open source, contributed by Uber. And you will see really good visualizations there. And you can, and the interesting part is that it is a client-only application. The data that you upload there will be on the browser, won't be synced on the server. And you can visualize data to the limits of like 200 MB is what I can definitely say that can work. And then, so one learning again is that location stream and task streams. So there are two streams. One is the location data that you are getting. Other is the order data that you are getting. If you have these two data, you can actually replicate the ground scenario, even in past what happened at that one particular point of time. But the important thing is that they need to be used in conjunction. They individually cannot help you out. So one of the learning that we had was that earlier we used to fine our partners basis the low order count that they used to do. If all other partners were getting good orders and this partner was not getting a good order, we felt that this guy is doing something wrong. And then we figured out that it is not the right way, moved on to the location intelligence part, and now we are merging them both. Visualization definitely helps. Do focus a lot on visualization in fraud detection at least. You never know what different kinds of frauds exist, so you cannot code for them. What you can do is that you can create methods or you can create those graphs, for the operations team to see that data so that they can, basis their operational know-how, figure out what is going wrong and what is going right. And then again, I mean, building the right location infrastructure, we have spent good amount of time on that. I would leave that for another talk, but yeah, that's in itself is an interesting and a challenging problem to solve at an infrastructure level, at a global level. So with that, I'll take a note on the presentation. I'll open for questions. Please, guys, shoot.
We're out of time. Let's take one question if there is.
Hi, that was a good talk. Thank you very much. So you mentioned reverse logistics somewhere in your talk. Can you just explain what is that?
So reverse logistics is that part. So as a simple thing, let's say you order a t-shirt from Amazon. Now the process of delivering that t-shirt to you is generally the forward logistics. Now let's say you did not like that t-shirt, you want to return it back. So that process of picking it up from you, doing the doorstep quality check, whether it is the same t-shirt that you have ordered and it's in the right condition, and then taking it back to the seller, is the reverse logistics part.
Also, if you have time and no one has questions, I would like to understand more on the integration of Kepler with your order system is what you mentioned. So I would like to understand the advantages that you got after that integration, so, what problem it exactly solved.
See, Kepler is generally a data exploration tool. It won't help you to create the ready visualization, which you can just directly put it in your dashboards. What it can do is that if there is data, you can actually slice and dice and view different kinds of visualizations on that to figure out what is the metric that you would want to chase. So if you go one level deeper, so Kepler is built on top of deck.gl. So you can use deck.gl to actually integrate it in your portals. deck.gl. I have also included some appendix in here. I'll keep updating on it so that the relevant links of the topics that I covered are covered there. Thank you so much, guys.